So, so what is effect of this loss of support that we are going to see? First of all, if the level 1 support goes down, the uterus will leave its place. What is a normal place of the uterus? If we examine vaginally, then the cervix lies above the level of ischial spines. If the cervix descends below the level of ischial spine, we call it a uterine descent. Okay, and this is because of loss of level 1 support. Now, if the anterior vaginal wall, if it loses its support, that is level 2 and or 3, then what will happen? The anterior vaginal wall will descend, but it will take bladder along with it, and we call it systocele. That is, normally the systocele or the bladder is above the level of ischial spines. If the apex of this bladder, it comes down the level of ischial spine, it will be called as systocele. If the urethra is showing mobility, it is called as urethrocele. Usually for urethra, the support is level 3. If the level 3 support is gone, then the urethra will show urethrocele. That is the anterior compartment. The uterus comes in a middle compartment. Okay. Now, the posterior vaginal wall, if it loses its support, then what will happen? Pouch of Douglas will descend down. The pouch of Douglas comes in a middle compartment as well as posterior compartment. And this pouch of Douglas usually contains loops of small intestine. So we call it an enterocele. If the lower part, that is level 3 support, is lost, then there will be the rectum which is descending down. We call it a rectocele. Okay. Now, if only third support is lost, then what will happen? There will be widening of the perineum and it will predispose the descent of the vagina because the third level support is not there. Now, what is vault prolapse? Whenever the patient has undergone hysterectomy, then apex of the vagina is called as vault. Usually, this apex of the vagina will retain its support, that is level 1, 2, and 3. But if the first support is lost or it is not reconstructed while doing hysterectomy, then this vault will come down, which is called as vault prolapse. Okay. Now, we have seen what is the effect of loss of this support. Now, because there is systocele, urethrocele, or uterine descent, what happens usually? That there are certain symptoms of the patient. That patient will say that something is coming out of the vagina. She may say that there is difficulty in micturition. If we elaborate the history further, she will say that there is something which is coming out the vagina while straining for micturition, and she has to put down that part. Then only she is able to pass urine, which is very typical of severe systocele or grade 3 systocele. Because of residual urine remaining inside, there can be urinary tract infection, which will give rise to burning. Because the bladder is not evacuated completely, she will have a frequent sense of passing urine. So there are urinary complaints which are very common next to a symptomatic patient, just something coming out the vagina. Okay. Now, they may complain of intermenstrual, postcoital, or postmenopausal bleeding. Why? We are going to see. They may say that there is a dragging pain in lower abdomen because all supports, they are stretched and they are having the sacral plexus as a nerve support. There will be dragging pain which is on the sacrum or lower abdomen or lower back. Okay. Sometimes because of this prolapse, congenital weakness, there can be a repeated pregnancy loss, that is abortion, or because of coital difficulty, there can be infertility as well. So there is varied group of symptoms with which patient can come to us. Now, what are the signs? First of all, when we examine the patient, we can see that there is descent of the vaginal wall with or without uterine descent. If it is only uterine descent, it is called as uterine prolapse. If it is uterine descent along with vaginal wall, it is called as a UV prolapse, that is uterovaginal prolapse. Okay. Now, when we are examining that prolapse part, we may observe that there is an ulcer. This ulcer is called as decubitus ulcer. We are going to see all these in detail again. The vagina, we all know, that is having rugosities because the vaginal epithelium is having stratified in columnar and squamous epithelium. It will produce rugosities, and in those rugosities there are, we all know that there are bacilli which will produce the acid. Okay, and that is one of the protective part, or that is a protective measure of the vagina or defense mechanism. This vaginal rugosities will be lost because of descent of the vaginal wall. There can be a supravaginal elongation. There can be stress incontinence. The tone of levator ani will be affected. There can be the intactness of the perineal body can be lost, and we can elicit the bulbocavernous reflex. Okay, or anal weak sign. We are going to see all these signs one by one. Okay. Now, first of all, something coming out of the uterus, of the vagina, and we are seeing that there is a descent. This descent, usually we mark it as a in degrees, the first degree descent, second degree, third degree, and procedentia. What is the marker from which we say that it is first degree, second degree? That it is a vestibule or the level of hymen or level of introitus. We all know that cervix, it lies above the level of ischial spines normally. If it is below the level of ischial spines but still it is into the vagina, it is called as first degree uterine descent. Okay, if the cervix comes up to the introitus, it is called as a second degree descent of the uterus. If the cervix is lying outside the introitus, it is called as a third degree descent. Mind well, we are talking about uterine prolapse. Okay, now when this fundus, even this picture is not correct, but fundus, it is outside the introitus, then we call it a procedentia. How do we know that the fundus is outside the introitus? When we are able to meet our two fingers above the level of fundus over here outside the introitus. We are passing one finger behind the prolapse part, one finger anteriorly, and we are able to meet our fingers above the fundus. We call it as a procedentia. This was all about uterine prolapse. Now this uterine prolapse can be along with the bladder prolapse, can be along with the prolapse of the bladder and prolapse of the rectum as well. And again, these will be degrees. Here we can see that they are at the level of introitus, isn't it? And enterocele is just above the introitus. So here we can say that it is a second degree systocele, it is second degree uterine descent, and it is a first degree enterocele. So this is how we decide degrees of the prolapse commonly. Okay. Now what is decubitus ulcer? We know that there is downward displacement of the vagina and the uterus. Because of that, the venous return of the part is affected and there is a venous congestion, just like varicose veins. So even small friction can lead to ulceration, and this ulcer is usually a non-healing ulcer unless and until we deposit or redeposit this uterus back into the vagina. Because of this ulceration, she may give a history of intermenstrual spotting, or there can be a postcoital spotting, or there can be a postmenopausal bleeding. The commonest reason is this decubitus ulcer. Unless and until we treat this decubitus ulcer, we are not able to give the operative or do the operative interference. Okay. Loss of rugosity. Here we can see anteriorly, right? There is a systocele, and we can see that this is a tense vaginal wall. So all rugosities are lost. Usually, commonly we see this kind of defect, and it is called as a central defect. That is, the supports, they are deficient into the center, and that is why the vagina is prolapsed. Okay. If this rugosity, presence of rugosity is there along with the systocele, it indicates that the support is lost at the lateral side of the vagina. And our routine colporaphy, what we do is anterior repair, is not effective if there is a lateral defect, that is the vaginal wall has left its support from lateral part. That is why it is very important finding that the rugosities are lost, then only the routine systosal repair is useful. Otherwise, we have to change our approach if the rugosities are maintained and the lateral defect is there. Okay. Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Huh, I'm not able to change the slide. Okay. So I'm waiting for the assistance. Please wait. I'm not able to change the slide. Please wait.
Yes, ma'am.
Siddharth, please wait.
Yes, ma'am.
हेलो
शिक्षा, आपने जिस व्यक्ति को कॉल किया है वो अन्य कॉल पर व्यस्त है.
Can anybody suggest me what is to be done? Because I am not able to change, I am not able to go to next slide. Rajesh, पुन्हा तसंच होतंय. मधून का होतंय असं आय डोंट नो. आय एम नॉट एबल टू चेंज द स्लाइड अगेन. काय होतं ते मला सांग, काय करायचंय ते. कशाने नाही होत. अच्छा, तिथे जाऊच नको. अच्छा, ओके.
होत नसेल ना तिथं, नाही तर
कुठे न्यायचा माऊस.
कुठे
ओके ओके, ठीक आहे ठीक आहे, ओके. So now we were talking about examination and we have talked about supravaginal elongation. What is this entirety of supravaginal elongation of the cervix? We know that the level 1 support, it supports the upper part of the cervix and it also supports the upper part or the vault of the vagina. But vagina is also having level 2 and level 3 support. If there is defect in level 2 and 3 and if the level 1 supports are very good, then what will happen? This level 1 supports, they will keep the rest of uterus in place, while the level 2 and 3, they are pulling the vagina down. What will happen? This supra vaginal portion of the cervix, it will get elongated. Okay. So it indicates that where exactly is the defect lies, in which level there is a defect. If there is no supra vaginal elongation and if there is descent, that means the level 1 is also defective. If supravaginal elongation is there, that means level 1 is good. Why we want to know this? Because we want to plan the management. How do we know this supravaginal elongation? What we do is, we have to pass a sound from cervical os, external os, and we have to reach till fundus. It will give you the total uterocervical length. Okay? While we are passing this, we can feel a snap over here, that is internal os. So this length gives you a total cervical length. Now take out the sound and put the sound into the lateral fornix. Okay, this will give you the length of infravaginal portion. Normally the infravaginal portion and the supravaginal portion, they are equal. If supravaginal portion is longer than the infravaginal, it tells you that there is a supravaginal elongation. Why we want to know this? Because it tells you that the level 1 support is good. Okay. Now going further. So many times the prolapse is associated with stress incontinence. What do we mean by stress incontinence? That when patient coughs or if there is increase in intra-abdominal pressure, there is loss of few drops of the urine from here, okay, which is called as a stress incontinence. Now, unless and until we demonstrate it is there or not, and whether it is because of hypermobility of the urethra, we cannot plan our treatment, whether we want to repair it, because usually it indicates urethrocele or hypermobility of the urethra. Okay, how it is done? We commonly do clinically a Bonis test. That is, we examine the patient full bladder. As you know, in gynecology, usually we examine patient after emptying the bladder. Here, we have to examine the patient with full bladder without emptying the bladder in lithotomy position. We keep our two fingers against the or by the side of urethra and we give a upward pressure, okay, against pubic symphysis. So what we are doing is we are reducing the mobility of the urethra, and now we ask patient to cough. If there is no leak, that means if we correct the hypermobility, patient is going to get relieved. Okay, even though we press and the leak persists, that means the reason is not hypermobility of the urethra and our operative is not going to help the patient. So we may have to further evaluate the patient. Okay, this is a clinical test, but there are other tests also. One is called as a Q-tip test. What we usually do is we pass a Q-tip from urethra till bladder neck and we ask patient to strain or do a Valsalva maneuver. Usually if the bladder neck or the support is good, the Q-tip will be elevated by almost 30 degrees. If this elevation is not there, that means the support is not good. Okay, we can also do the pressure studies in urodynamics and we will demonstrate that why there is a stress incontinence. All this is to be done before we do any operative procedure. Okay, now one more evaluation is to be done, which is called as tone of levator ani. We know that levator ani, it gives a major portion of level 2 support and some part of level 3 support, because some muscles of the levator ani, they are attached to perineal body as well. Okay, now how do we know the tone of levator ani? We insert two fingers into the vagina, or one finger in vagina and one finger into the rectum, which is not very comfortable. So normally we insert two fingers into the vagina and we ask patient to contract her pelvic floor muscles. Okay, now what can be the result? Either we feel no contraction at all, so very weak tone of the levator ani. We may just feel flicker. It is also a not good support or a good levator ani tone. It may be very weak. Patient is not able to hold back. Still it is weak. Or patient is able to contract. She is not able to hold. We may say it is moderate. There can be a very good tone of the levator ani, or there can be a very strong tone of levator ani. So tone of levator ani is going to give you the type of level 2 and level 3 support. If this tone is very bad, then it is advised that patient should do Kegels exercise before operative. If she doesn't do these exercises, then there is chance that the prolapse or our repair can recur and the condition can recur. Okay. Now, there is one more thing that we have to do, evaluation of perineal body. We all know that perineal body is having 9 muscles attached to it and it supports lower part of the vagina. Okay. Now, as a birth trauma, there can be injury to the perineal body, and if it is not repaired in time or it is not adequately repaired, then what will happen? This perineal body support will be weakened. We can see over here that the rectal mucosa is seen. These are external sphincter muscles. There are other muscles of the perineal body, and this is a fat. So this is just because of the third degree perineal tear. Even second degree perineal tear, if it is left untreated or unsuited, can lead to damage to the perineal body. It will pull the vagina down and it may lead to prolapse further. Okay. Now, there is one more evaluation which is called as bulbocavernous reflex. Okay, what we usually, or it can be called as anal weak sign as well. Okay, what we do is we lightly touch the labia minora or we squeeze the clitoris. What we normally should observe that there is upward movement of the external anal sphincter. It indicates that there is no neurological damage. If this movement is not observed, then the neurological damage is much more. Commonly found in obesity, it is also seen in diabetes as well, or even in obstetric traumas. If there is history of instrumental delivery, damage to pudendal nerve, all these things, they will lead to loss of this bulbocavernous reflex or absent anal weak sign. This indicates that the damage is having neurological component as well. We have to investigate further. So this was a physical examination of the prolapse. Along with detailed history taking, along with reasons that why there is prolapse, along with noting the menopausal status of the patient, along with doing investigations for thyroid dysfunction, for diabetes, noting her BMI, this physical examination prepares us or gives us guideline that what is the diagnosis. Usually the diagnosis of prolapse is clinical. It doesn't require any investigation. But to rule out the reason for prolapse, we may need certain investigations. We may need ultrasonography. We may need thyroid dysfunction test, or we may need diabetes test. But otherwise, the diagnosis of prolapse is clinical. Up till now, we were diagnosing prolapse in degrees, first degree, second degree, third degree. But it is usually a subjective thing. And when we want to have a data on that, we may not have evidence generated. That is why we can quantify the prolapse. It is called as pelvic organ prolapse quantification. So it is also called as POPQ classification. It seems very difficult or complex, but it is not that difficult. There are 9 points mentioned. One is called as AA, second is BA, then there is AP, BP, there is C, there is D. Okay, these are the points. Yala decline karayche na hi je madhun madhun yete di. Just wait. Few minutes left before we complete this lecture. Decline correct. Okay. Here we can see that this C is the lowermost portion of the cervix. D is highest point of pouch of Douglas. Okay. This AA point is 3 cm inside the attachment of the hymen. Okay. This AP point is again 3 cm inside. Okay. Apart from that, we have to measure various lengths. Okay. We have to measure our total vaginal length. We have to measure a length between, or the perineal length, or the opening of the vagina. Various measurements we have to take. Okay. Now, what is this BA and BP? Okay. Usually, they should be proximal to AA and AP. But whenever there is descent of this vaginal wall, we can imagine that this VA will come down. Okay. Now, what we are supposed to put is, we are supposed to put all these measurements into a grid. Okay. You can see here that AA is minus 3 centimeters from the hymen attachment. BA is almost at the same point. Okay. C is 8 centimeter inside the hymen attachment. Okay. D is 10 centimeter. We know that the posterior vaginal wall is longer. Okay. AP is minus 3. That is inside. Plus is outside the vagina. Minus is inside the vagina. Okay. So this is how this grid shows the normal position of uterus and vagina. That is this part. Okay. Now here what has happened? The C has come over here. Instead of inside the vagina, the C is lying outside the vagina. Okay. Now here you can see it is plus 8. That is from vagina, it is 8 centimeter outside. You can see AA is 3 centimeter outside the vagina. BA is 8 centimeter outside the vagina. This is a third degree uterovaginal prolapse, isn't it? You can see that AP is also outside 3 centimeter. BP is 8 centimeter. And that is why there is no D point. Why? Because the posterior fornix is not remained. What is purpose of this POPQ classification? That if we put it into the grid, we can definitely follow this patient up. Or when we want to study further, that what is the reason for the defect and what is the effect of repair? What kind of repair is more effective when we want to study? So this is for research purpose. Quantification is very essential. So even though we are continuing to say first degree, second degree, third degree prolapse, this quantification is a better way to classify prolapse, which will give you the quantification that where exactly the level the defect lies. If the defect is only in BA, you can see that it is a level 2 defect. If it is in C, you can see it is a level 1 defect. Here it will be level 2. Okay. When the total perineal, you can see over here, when these lengths they are increased, there is widening of the vaginal opening. This indicates level 3 support. Okay. So exactly to know that where is the loss of support, this POPQ classification helps us, and we can further decide that what should be the management of this prolapse. The management extends from conservative to radical surgery. Okay. Non-surgical to radical surgery. So in next lecture, that is next Monday, we are going to see management of this uterovaginal prolapse. Okay. So thank you very much. I hope that you understood whatever I was talking about. Thank you. If there are any questions, are there any questions? Okay. See, no question. Anybody else is having question? I suppose there are no questions. Are there questions?
Thank you so much. So we'll end this session. We'll meet tomorrow again. Thank you.